James from UK. So currently he is visiting researcher at the Institute of Statistical Mathematics. Okay. So he will give you a lecture on statistics today and 2 weeks later. Yeah.
Yep, 15. Okay, thank you for the introduction. So, good afternoon. I'm Mathew Ames, and currently I'm at the Department of Statistical Modeling at the Institute of Statistical Mathematics in Tokyo. And I'm very happy to present this short course on decision theory, inference, and hypothesis testing. So, now I've been told that there's a mixture of backgrounds in the room, such as economics, medical science, engineering, and information sciences. So you're all different, interested in various different kinds of phenomena and events. So you may want to analyze data observed from these phenomena and events and capture the characteristics and understand your data. So you all have this in common. And maybe you want to predict the future phenomena and events. So for such purposes, a rigorous statistical approach is very useful. Okay, so this lecture course that I'll present consists of 2 lectures. So today, I'm gonna recap some fundamentals of statistical inference and introduce hypothesis testing. And then in 2 weeks' time for the second lecture, I'll introduce some statistical modeling techniques that are gonna be useful for statistical inference and applying to your own problems in practice. So for today, some points to keep in mind. A notion of a probability triple, which I'll introduce to begin with, and then some key concepts in statistical inference, such as unbiased, effective, and consistent estimators. And also, finally, the central limit theorem, which is key in statistics. Okay. So this is the outline for this today. I'll start by looking at some fundamentals of probability. Then we'll move on to conditional probability and Bayes' theorem, and then random vectors, and finally estimation and inference. So to begin with, fundamental in all of machine learning, pattern recognition, and data mining is this concept of uncertainty. And to deal with this, we apply probability theory and statistical decision theory. So where is this uncertainty coming from? So there's various sources of uncertainty. So firstly, noise on observation processes, which is your measurements, which are, of course, in the real world, this is noisy. Secondly, noise on fundamental physical processes, such as in stochastic models. And also due to the finite sample size realizations of real-world behavior. So you're only ever going to collect a small sample compared to the real world. So in order to make robust, optimal predictions, conditional on what we observe in our data, we need to understand and apply probability theory and decision theory fundamentals. Okay, so a key concept in probability theory, the key building block, is this notion of a probability triple, which is the Kolmogorov definition of a probability space. So the probability space, or triple, is a concept which serves as a rigorous mathematical ground for the conventional idea of randomness. So this model of the real world situation or experiment consists of 3 things, a triple. So firstly, for a given experiment, all possible outcomes which might happen consist of a set called the sample space. Okay, let me give a simple example to illustrate this. Okay, so say our experiment is drawing one draw of a ball from a bucket which consists of two red balls, three blue balls. Okay, so our sample space here, omega, is red ball one, red ball two, blue ball one, blue ball two, and blue ball three. This is our sample space. Each of these is an possible outcome from our experiment is draw one ball at random from this bucket. Omega is this space, this possible outcomes. So now they're the most basic outcomes. So the second element in the triple is a collection of all possible events. So for example, we could have an event of the draw is a red ball. Okay? So, and here, so this is called a sigma algebra of the collection of events that we want to consider for this probability space. And the third element of the probability triple is a probability measure. So here we have a probability, it's a measure which attaches to each of these individual outcomes a probability. So if they're all equally likely, say 1 on 5 for any of these, R1, R2. So maybe the probability of this example of drawing a red is just 2 on 5. Okay. So this is a very simple example to illustrate these three different components of the probability triple. And of course, so in your experimental world, whatever you're applying this to, a probability space represents the model for this real world situation. So the choice of these three elements is up to the statistician. So the probability triple in more detail. So the sample space omega is this space of random outcomes, so the states of nature, so in this case, which ball? And every instance of the real world situation or each run of the experiment must produce exactly one outcome, which is an elementary element. And then we have this sigma algebra, which is usually denoted with a calligraphic F, which is a collection of all events, so which can potentially be zero or more elementary elements. So this is up to the modeler to decide. So yeah, an event's been observed when the outcome of a trial is a member of the event. So here we note that the same elementary event may be a member of many events. So it depends on how you set up your experiment. And of course, your probability measure P is a function which tells you the probability of the events or the sigma algebra, maps our sigma algebra F to this interval 0, 1. So some important things to note about sigma algebras. So it's a subset of all events of the outcomes. So all possible combinations, we consider a subset of that. And it must contain the null set, so empty set. It must be closed under complements. It should be complements, not complements. So if an event A is a member of F, then the complement of A, so everything else that's not A, also has to be in F. And also closed under countable unions, so a number of different events, the union must also be in F. So some properties of the probability measure P is that it must be countably additive and measures the entire sample space should be equal to 1. And this is just a recap of some basic probability that you probably already come across. Okay, so now this is the building block, probability triple. Now extend this to random variables. We have that any probability distribution defines a probability measure via the red on negative and a negative derivative, which I'm not going to go into because that's involve a whole another course of lectures on measure theory. And then we have the random variables. Say a random variable x is a measurable function which maps our outcomes, the sample space omega, to another measurable space s called the state space. So the probability of a random variable x in A is denoted with in this form. So probability of an outcome small omega in this set omega, such that this random variable x is in A. Okay. So sigma algebras. So if our omega space, our sample space, is countable, this means we can typically define our sigma algebra F as the power set of omega, which is 2 to the omega, so whether or not each event occurs. And then this is the biggest collection of events. Okay, but also we need to be careful. If we have uncountable omega, then we have problems, of course, 2 to the omega, if omega is uncountable. So it's typical to consider a much smaller sigma algebra, such that the Borel algebra of sigma is a good choice. Okay, but again, I'm not going to go into these details of measure theory. Okay, so let's now consider the basic elements comprising the probability theory, which is triple. So intuitively, the probability of an event E is a real number which should measure how likely this event is to occur. So in order to give this a firm, rigorous footing, mathematical footing, Kolmogorov, back in the 30s, set out the following axioms. So a probability measure P should satisfy, firstly, that every event, the probability of any event should be between 0 and 1. The probability of the entire space should be equal to 1. And then any sequence, infinite, possibly infinite, of mutually exclusive events, so can't happen at the same time, should be equal to the sum of the individual probabilities of the events. Okay. And similarly, for any finite sequence, we have the probability of the union of the events should be equal to the sum of the individual probabilities. So the probability of the complement of the event C should be equal, so C not happening, should be equal to 1 minus the probability of the event. The probability of the null set should be equal to 0. And then also we have that if an event 1 is a subset of event 2, so contained in event 2, then we should see that the probability of event 1 happening should be smaller or equal to the probability of the larger event happening. This is called an increasing measure. Okay. So also we have the probability of event 1 and event 2 happening should be equal to the probability of event 1 plus the probability of event 2 minus the probability that both of them happen. So of course, if these are mutually exclusive, then this cancels out. And then extending this to more than two events, so n events, we get the additive law of probability for multiple events, which is just an extension of this line here. Okay. So there are some basic axioms introduced by Kolmogorov. So we note that the axioms state only the conditions an assignment of probabilities must satisfy, but they don't tell us how to assign probabilities to events. So how do we do this? So there's two different approaches, the frequentist approach and the Bayesian approach. So let's start with the frequentist approach. which is the most widely held. Okay, so in the frequentist world, the definition of probability is that the basic idea is that we can repeat experiments. Okay, so if the experiment is repeated independently over and over again, infinitely many times, which is, of course, isn't possible, the proportion of time that event E occurs is the probability. So suppose that the experiment is repeated N times, then the probability of event E is the number of times E occurs divided by the number of times you run the experiment. So in the frequentist world, this is the limit as N tends to infinity. But as I said, we can't actually do that. Okay. So the interpretation is that probability is roughly equal in the real world to the proportion of chances of occurrence of the event. So it's straightforward to check that the so-called the defined probability measure satisfies the axioms. Yeah, that's it. This. Okay. So yeah. We can't repeat the experiment infinitely many times, so it's theoretical. And also, in many situations, we can only see the run of the experiment one time. So, for example, what is the probability that it's going to rain tomorrow? We can't run that experiment more than one time. Well, not at the moment, anyway. So, essentially, assigning probabilities in practice relies on prior knowledge of the experimenter, or the belief or the model that's been built before. So a simple model is to assume that all outcomes are equally likely. Okay. So suppose we have N, capital N outcomes. If we assume that they're all equally likely to one another, so the probability of omega k is equal to small p for any of the outcomes, then we see that axioms 2 and 3 impose that if we sum up all of the p probabilities, we get capital N times p should be equal to 1, so the probability is just 1 over capital N. Okay, this is very simple. So for an event E made up of k simple outcomes events, it follows from axiom 3 from before that the probability of E should just be equal to k over N, so number of favorable cases divided by number of total cases. Okay. So this is the classic definition of probability. So it's necessary to count the number of different ways a given event of interest can occur. So this is combinatorics. So some further rules to do with that, along the lines of this probability setup. So firstly, we have the multiplication rule. So if an operation can be described as a sequence of k steps, and the number of ways of completing step I is ni, then the total number of ways of completing the operation is just multiply the number of ways at each point, n1, n2, all the way up to nk. So this is the multiplication rule. Then we have permutations. So a permutation of the elements of a set is an ordered sequence of those elements. The number of different permutations of n elements here, p, n, is just n factorial. Okay. So that's permutations. Then we have combinations, where a combination is a subset of elements selected from a larger set. So the number of combinations of size r that can be selected from a set of n elements is n r. This is the notation for n choose r. Just to see, this is given by n factorial over r factorial multiplied by n minus r factorial. Okay. Okay. So now we want to consider conditional probability, which is probability given that we know something has happened. So this setup, this Kolmogorov setup of a probability space that we've looked at, naturally allows this extension to consider conditional probabilities. So every set A with non-zero probability, so probability A greater than zero, defines another probability measure, which is, this is how we write this, probability of B given A. So maybe the probability is going to rain tomorrow given that it's rained today. And this is given by the probability that it rains today and rains tomorrow divided by the probability that it rains today. Okay, so this is conditional probability, and it's right at the heart of all of the techniques in machine learning, this basic building block. So we say that two events are independent, A and B, if probability that A and B happen is just the product of A, probability of A and probability of B. Okay, that's independence. Okay. So three rules of probability. So we have the sum rule, which is the probability of X is equal to the sum over all the choices of Y, all the outcomes of Y, the probability of X and Y happening. The product rule, so probability of X and Y happening is equal to the probability of Y happening given that X has happened multiplied by the probability that X happened. And then we have symmetry, which is that it's quite straightforward. Okay, so all of these three rules combined give us this relationship known as Bayes' theorem, which is really is central to the whole of machine learning, which is given by this simple formula, where the denominator here, probability of X, is known as the evidence. So this when you calculate this, this is the conditional probability multiplied by each of the conditioning arguments, and then sum over all of these Y outcomes. So, working with properties of random variables. So let's look at a univariate random variable Y. So if we assume that the random variable has a distribution, capital F, so cumulative distribution, which admits a density function with respect to a Lebesgue measure, so small f. So here the capital notation is typically used for cumulative distribution function and a lowercase f for probability density function. So we have the expectation of y is given by the continuous integral of y multiplied by this density function. And we typically denote this by mu. And then we have the variance of y, which is given by the integral of the square of the y, the differences of y from the center, mu, from the mean, multiplied by the probability density function. And we can show this quite simply that in a few steps that this is the expectation of square of y minus mu, and if we expand this all out, we see that we have this difference of squares here. So we can see, looking at this last line, we can see that the variance is always going to be positive because these two terms here are positive. Oh well, at least non-negative. And we can see that the variance of a constant random variable is zero, so that two terms at the bottom are the same. The variance of a variable in a data set is zero if and only if entries have the same value. So every entry is the same. Okay, so this makes sense. The variance is also invariant with respect to changes in a location parameter. So here, so the variance of, if we multiply our random variable y by a, and we have this location shift b, then B doesn't alter the variance at all, but we have this A squared term in front of the variance of Y. Now if we look at a finite sum of uncorrelated random variables, then we just see this is equal to the sum of the variances. So variance of x and y happening together is variance of x plus variance of y. And then we have this third term, which is two times the covariance of x and y. So if x and y are uncorrelated, this is zero. Generalizing this with multiples, you can see how this plays out in the variance. Okay. So in general, for the sum of n variables, we have this expression for our variance of y. So the sum of the variances plus two times the sum of the covariances. So what's the covariance? The covariance between two random variables, y1 and y2, is defined as follows. So it's the expectation of the variance of y1 about its mean multiplied by the variance of y2 about its mean, the expectation of that product. And this collapses down to this expectation of y1, y2, minus the product of the means. Okay, so these are some properties of the covariance function. So we see if we have y1, y2, y3, y4 are random variables, and we have these constants, these lowercase a, b, c, d are just constants, then we can see the properties of the covariance. Okay, so we've looked at some really basic building blocks of probability theory, probability triple and conditional probability. Now we want to introduce the topic of statistical inference. Now, generally speaking, statistical inference involves methods that we can use to draw conclusions and make decisions about a population. However, we don't have access to the whole population, and we have to make do with a sample that we draw from a population. I mean, this is always the case in a real world setting. So this subset of the real world is called our sample. Now, if this sample that we draw is a good sample, basically, if it's an effective representation of the population, what we observe on the sample we can use to generalize across the whole population, at least to some extent and with some confidence. But it's important that we take random chance factors into consideration. Okay, let's have a look at the statistical inference. So populations are often described by their distribution of their values. So for instance, it's common practice to refer to a normal distribution when the variable of interest is thought to be normally distributed. Okay. So typically, when we're performing statistical inference on a population, we focus on drawing conclusions about, say, the mean or the variance, or the proportion of individuals in a population that belong to a particular class that we were interested in to draw some conclusions, some meaningful conclusions. Or for example, the difference between two subpopulations. So say for example, in a drug trial, whether this drug is effective. We want to see a control population and a population of individuals taking the drug. Is there any difference between the means? So mu1 minus mu2. Okay. So obviously, I mean, these parameters are unknown, otherwise we don't need to do any statistical inference to start with. So the whole concept of statistical inference is to estimate the unknown parameters of the population using the model that we're interested in. Okay, not that line. So random sampling is very important to make sure our small subsample of the entire population is representative of the of the population, and to provide a framework for applying all of the theory that we develop on probability to our problems of sampling. So if the sample's not random and is based on experimenter's judgment or flawed in some way, then the statistical methods that we develop won't work properly and will draw incorrect decisions and conclusions from our analysis. So what do we mean by random sample? Okay, so we should define this properly. So before we draw our sample, the observations are modeled as random variables. Say we're drawing a sample of n data points. So the set of observations x1 to xn constitutes a random sample if, one, each xi is an independent from any of the other draws, so independent random variables, and every xi has the same probability distribution. So this is a very common assumption to make when performing statistical inference. It's often abbreviated as IID, so independent and identically distributed. So we all also, it's common to apply the terms random sample to the set of observed variables. So here we typically use the lowercase letters to distinguish a random sample from the uppercase letters, which is the random variable. So random variable, uppercase letters, and then draw some samples, lowercase. Okay. So we've drawn our sample, and then what we want to do something useful with our sample. So any numerical measure we calculate from the sample is referred to as a statistic. So say we're interested in a parameter. This is, we typically denote this with a theta, say the mean or the variance. Let's denote this with theta. So the only information we have to estimate this parameter theta comes from our sample that we've drawn. So theta hat is some function of these n samples that we've drawn. And thus, because it's a function of random variables, it must have a probability distribution of its own. And we refer to this as the sampling distribution. Which generally depends on the population distribution and how many samples we've drawn. After the sample's been selected, theta hat takes on a particular value, say lowercase theta here. This is the estimate that we've calculated of the true parameter, which is unknown, theta. Okay, so here the hat notation is a convention to distinguish sample-based quantities, so an estimator of the parameter from the population parameter, which is, so theta is the true population parameter, which is unknown. And also the same convention applies to lowercase and uppercase letters here. So there's two notable exceptions, which are two of the most common parameters to estimate in a sample. So firstly, the sample mean. We usually denote with a x bar for no good reason, but this is just the typical notation that the statisticians use. So x bar for the mean, and for the standard deviation of the sample, we typically use s, or s squared for the variance. Okay. So now let's suppose that the random variable x of interest is normally distributed. So we don't know the mean, so we want to estimate the mean mu, but let's suppose that we know the standard deviation sigma. So we, from a random sample, we draw a random sample. A natural estimator to use is just the arithmetic average, arithmetic mean. It just sum up all the elements, divide by n. Okay, so that's our estimator. So as the sample of the population is random, it needs to be representative of the whole population, and the population mean mu should be close to this observed sample mean x bar. So of course this depends on how many samples we draw, and also due to random chance of how representative our sample is. Okay. So what does it mean when we say that mu should be close to this sample mean? So this is where we look at the sampling distribution of x bar to answer the question. So we know that each xi from the sample follows this normal distribution with mean mu and standard deviation sigma. And they're independent. These are our assumptions on our random sample. Then because we have linear combinations of a normal random variable are still normally distributed, we can conclude that x bar has a normal distribution with a mean given by this calculation here. So we see the expectation of x bar is just the expectation here of the formula for our x bar, which when we expand out, we have 1 over n summing the expectation of xi. And since we have iid, this just equals mu. And we have the variance in a similar fashion equals sigma squared over n. OK. So the sampling distribution of our mean, x bar, as an estimator of mu, the population mean, is given by this normal distribution. So the mean of mu, and then the standard deviation, sigma over square root of n, if the original population is assumed to be normal. So this is good. This shows us that our choice of x bar is a normal random variable centered around the population mean. This is what we want. And also that as we draw more and more samples n, the spread, the standard deviation, narrows in and on our mu. So the larger the sample, the more accurate the estimation is. And this happens at a rate of 1 over square root of n in the standard deviation. Okay, so if you look at the figure here, you can see the normal distribution starts out quite wide and then shrinks in quite rapidly on the mu. And also we can note here that the mu x bar, sigma x bar equal to these values doesn't require a normality assumption. Okay. Now, since the purpose of the statistical inference that we're carrying out is to generalize from this small sample that we have of the real world to the population. So we can do this in two ways. Firstly, we have estimation, which includes point estimation, so just saying this is the mean, or interval estimation, where we can say this is what we think the mean is, but with this interval of values which we can be reasonably confident, where we'll come on to what reasonably confident means. And then we have hypothesis testing that can be carried out on this statistical inference. Okay, and we'll come to that later. Okay, point estimation. So we're trying to estimate an unknown parameter theta of a population, for instance, the mean, from our random sample. So we select an estimator, which must be a statistic, say theta hat, which is this function of our sample. So since it's a function of random variables, our estimator theta hat is a random variable, which has its mean and its variance, and its probability distribution known as a sampling distribution. Okay, so we're just recapping here. So for instance, to estimate the population mean mu, we suggested the sample mean, which is here. This is what we're looking at. And we derived that it has the first two moments of the sampling distribution are mu, which is what we want, and sigma squared over n, the variance. And we showed this. Okay. So why did we choose this sample mean as our approach of estimating the mean? We could choose any number of measures. Okay, so for example, we could have just chosen the first observed value as our estimate of theta. Or we could take the first and last and average them. Or some combination of the first and last. So how do we know what the best estimator for our parameter is? So we need to define what we mean by best. So what do we want out of our estimator? So certainly we should want that our estimates of the parameter are close to the true unknown parameter theta. But what does close mean? So firstly, we don't actually know what the parameter theta is, so that's unknown. And secondly, the estimator is a random variable. So let's concretely define what we mean by desirable properties of an estimator. So number one, the first desirable property that a good estimator should have is unbiasedness. So this is the definition of unbiasedness. So theta hat, as an estimator for theta, is unbiased if and only if the mean of the sampling distribution is equal to what we're trying to estimate, whatever the value of theta is. Okay, so that's very straightforward, unbiased. Okay, so on average, our samples of the real world should give us our theta. Okay, so if we use an estimator of a parameter which is not unbiased, and there's many occasions when you want to do this for other reasons, then the difference between our expected theta hat and our true theta is called the bias, just this subtraction. Okay, and then you'll get a systematic error if you use this estimator to estimate theta. So we've already shown that the sample mean x bar is an unbiased estimator for mu. So this unbiasedness is, in general, one of the most desirable properties of an estimator, although sometimes it's outweighed by other factors. So one shortcoming is that it will generally not provide a unique estimator for a given problem of estimation. So for example, if we look at the estimator for mu, we can see that the expectation of the drawing from the first random sample out of our random sample of n's is going to be equal to mu. So that's unbiased. Or drawing the first and last and averaging is unbiased. Any of these approaches are unbiased. So it's not unique. It just happens to be that the first one I showed you is the natural way of thinking about drawing sampling, estimating a mean. Okay, so we need further criteria for deciding which of all of these different unbiased estimators is optimal for estimating our parameter. Okay, so we should consider the variances of our theta x bar and theta 1 hat. So we showed that the variance of our sample mean is equal to sigma squared on m, while we have that directly the variance of just, if we just use the first sample, then the variance is always going to be equal to sigma squared. So we can see that the variance of x bar is n times smaller than just taking the first sample from our data. So it's clear here that you're far more likely that x bar is going to be closer to the mean on a given random sample than just using the first data point. Okay, well, this is intuitive, but this is the concrete theory behind this. Okay. So fact, estimators with smaller variances are more likely to produce estimates close to the true value on any given random sample. So a logical idea is to choose from the set of unbiased estimators an estimator that has minimum variance. And we refer to this property as efficiency. So an estimator with minimum variance is said to be efficient amongst this set of unbiased estimators. So we have unbiasedness and efficiency. Okay, can you see that? Okay, so this is just a little schematic of what we're talking about here. So if you consider each value taken by an estimator as a shot at a target, where the target, the middle here, is the bullseye, is the population parameter of interest. So here, A, we can see that there's high bias here because all of these points here are quite far away from the bullseye, but also low variability. Lots of tight cluster, was a lot, there's tight clustering in the samples. Okay. Then B, we have low bias because these samples here are drawn around the bullseye, but also high variability in the samples. Okay. And then C, high bias, high variability. So this is not a good situation for an estimator. And then the ideal situation in D here, where we've got a low bias and also low variability in the samples, in the estimator samples. Okay. So if we take this argument to the limit, the idea of minimum variance becomes one such that we desire the probability that the estimator is in some way close to the true parameter increases to one as n increases. So as we draw a larger sample, we get asymptotically close to the true parameter with probability one. So we desire an estimator that's more and more precise as we draw more and more samples. Okay, so that's intuitive. So these estimators we call consistent. So this is the third property that we look for in an estimator. Okay. So an easy way to check that our unbiased estimator is consistent is to show that the variance decreases to zero in the limit. So as our sample n grows to infinity, in theory, so for instance, the variance of our sample mean, as we defined before, x bar, is equal to sigma squared over n, which clearly tends to zero as n tends to infinity. So we can see that our sample mean is consistent for mu. Whereas on the other hand, if we look at some of the other suggested estimators, so the variance of just taking the first sample, that's not going to tend to zero because it's a constant. Neither are any of the other two suggested estimators. So none of the other ones are consistent. Okay. So we've thus seen that the sample mean, our x bar, is unbiased, consistent, and efficient. And also, in most practical situations, this is important. In most practical situations, we can show that the population, where we estimate the population mean, the variance, So the sample mean, in most practical situations, the sample mean can be shown to be has the lowest variance of any of the estimators. So in general, it's a very, very robust approach to take. And so a very good estimator. So here we note that there's several other criteria for assessing the goodness of point estimations. But on this course, we're only going to talk about these three points I mentioned. Okay, so we're always going to use the sample mean as an estimate of the population mean. Okay. So we're using the sample mean. Well, we're estimating this population parameter with our chosen estimator. We know that there's actually a zero probability of the estimate using our sample being exactly the true value. So we have to accept that it's an approximation of the true value. So when we report, we have a data set and we report just a point estimate, what can we tell from that? There's nothing in this value that shows us how confident we should be. So it's usually desirable to give some kind of idea of the precision of the estimation. So here we look at the standard error of the estimator, where you define this as sigma with a lowercase theta hat. So also, if the standard error involves some unknown parameters that can be estimated, then we substitute these into the sigma, and we have hats on the sigma as well. Okay, this is usually the case. Okay, so let's look again at our estimate of the mean with our sample mean x bar. Okay, so we know that our expectation of x bar is equal to mu, so unbiased. Our variance of x bar is equal to sigma squared over n. So the standard error of our sample mean, our estimator, is equal to sigma over square root of m. However, we can't report a numerical value for this standard error, as it depends in turn on the population standard deviation, which we don't know, usually, pretty much always. So here we have a natural estimate of the population standard deviation using just taking a sample standard deviation, so the standard deviation of the sample, which here we have this square root, and we use this 1 over n minus 1, which I'll show you why that's the case in a few slides. And then we can plug this into our estimate of the standard error of our sample mean x bar. So we have s here instead of sigma, because this is estimated from the sample. Okay, so this is the usual setup in the real world. So when the estimator is normally distributed, we can be reasonably confident that the true value of the parameter theta lies within two standard areas of the estimate. So here we have this 68, 95, 99 rule. So in a normal distribution, 68% of the data is in within one standard deviation, 95% is in within two standard deviations, and then 99% within three. Okay. So if we look at two standard deviations, we're covering 95% of the distribution. And even in cases when this estimator that we're looking at is not normally distributed, if we look at something called Chebyshev's inequality, then this guarantees that the estimate of the parameter will deviate from the true value by as much as four standard deviations, only 6% of the time. Okay. So that's important to fall back on when we don't have a normal distribution. So we want to determine an interval of plausible values for our parameter, rather than just this point of x bar. We want an interval, which will cover, say, 95% confidence. We can have 95% confidence in the true parameter being in this interval. Okay, so we'll be a bit more concrete in the next few slides about this. Okay, interval estimation. So, yeah, okay. So let's look at an example. Okay, so this data set is from a journal of heat transfer, which is looking at a newly introduced method of measuring thermal conductivity of a type of iron, Armco iron. So at 100 degrees Fahrenheit and a power input of 550 watts, these following measurements of thermal conductivity were obtained. Okay, so this is our data set. So what can we say, what can we do? What can we say about our data? So if we just look at a point estimate of the mean, then we calculate this to the sample mean that we've been looking at all along. We get this value, 41.924. How confident can we be in this mean? So we know that the standard error of the sample mean of an estimator is this sigma over square root of n. But we don't actually know this sigma, so we can approximate this with the sample standard deviation, which if we just calculate it with the formula I showed before, and we get 0.284, then we see that the standard error of the sample mean, so sigma hat x bar, is equal to 0.0898. Okay. So that means that the standard error is about 0.2% of the sample mean. So if you calculate that. So it's quite small, relatively speaking, I think. So we've got a relatively precise point estimate of the true mean of the thermal conductivity. Now, if we assume that the thermal conductivity is normally distributed, and then if we take twice the standard error, well, the estimated standard error that we calculated before, we have 0.1796, and thus our interval of being highly confident, so 95% interval, this is assuming that we have normal distribution of thermal conductivity, is in this region here, 41.7 to 42.1. And then, as we alluded to earlier, if we can't assume that we have a normal distribution, then we should use 4 times the standard error. So we have this larger interval here. Okay, so assuming normal distribution allows us to have a tighter interval with the same level of confidence. So these intervals that we're talking about are referred to as confidence intervals. So it's an interval in which we can assert with a reasonable degree of certainty that the true population parameter is going to lie within this interval. So firstly, when you're performing some kind of data analysis, you choose the confidence level first, and then carry out the analysis rather than looking at the data and then seeing which confidence level gives you the conclusion you want. It's very important in terms of experimental design. So say we choose a confidence level of, say, alpha is equal to 5. So we have a 95% confidence interval. And so typically alpha of 10, 5, or 1% is used. So the higher this confidence level, the more strongly that we believe that the parameter lies within this interval. Okay, so the first remark about confidence intervals is that information about the precision of the estimation is conveyed by the length of the interval. So a short interval implies that we have a very precise estimate of our parameter, whereas a wide interval gives a message that we don't have a good estimate of this parameter. Okay. And the second remark is in terms of interpretation. So it's sometimes tempting to think about this confidence interval for theta, saying that there's a, say, a 95% confidence interval. It's saying that there's a 95% probability that theta belongs to it. But this isn't exactly true. So the truth is that the 95% refers to the percentage of all samples of the same size. So repeat, if you repeatedly draw and draw and draw, then 95% of the time, you'll have an interval which contains the true theta. So it's slightly different than the interpretation here, but it's important to recognize that what the confidence percentage means. Yeah, so in the long run, 95% of these intervals will capture the true theta. So the understanding this interpretation correctly relies on an understanding that the confidence interval is a random interval because the endpoints are calculated using the sample that we draw, and therefore they're random variables. However, once we calculate the confidence interval from the data sample, the true value either belongs to it or it doesn't belong to it. So there's no probability statements involved in a confidence interval. That's why we say confidence level rather than probability. Okay. So as an intuitive example, if we have our sample of 100 data points here, drawn from a standard normal, so 0, 1, 0 mean and standard deviation of 1. So these are all our confidence intervals, 95% confidence intervals, calculated using the random samples. Then we see that there's 1, 2, 3, 4. There's 4 occasions out of 100 where this confidence interval doesn't actually contain the true value, which is 0 of the mean. So 96%, 96, 95%. So this is a reasonable expectation. But of course, when you're carrying out a data analysis, you don't know whether you're green or red. So you don't know the true value, and you don't know whether this confidence interval you've actually calculated does in fact contain the true parameter. But you can say that 95% of the time it will do. So this is a key point to understand for confidence intervals. Okay. So a basic idea when constructing a confidence interval can be understood if we consider this simple situation. So suppose we have a normal population. So we don't know the mean mu, but let's suppose we know the variance sigma squared, which is unrealistic because typically we don't know either, but let's just assume for now that we know the variance. So we have a random sample to xn such that we have that each of our xi are distributed normally with mu and sigma and independent. Okay. So in this situation, our sample mean x bar is distributed, as we showed before, with a mean mu and standard deviation sigma over square root of n. So if we standardize this normal, this is called a standardization procedure here. So what we're attempting to do here is to take the data and standardize to standard normal, so mean 0 and standard deviation 1. This is how we calculate these z scores. So this random variable z is equal to our x bar minus the mu and then divide by the standard deviation. So we can see that this is going to give us a standard normal. Okay. So this is all just to make the whole process of calculating confidence intervals straightforward and standard. So suppose we want a confidence interval for mu with 95% confidence. Then from our random sample, which we know is which we'll know will give a random interval, say L to U, so lower and upper confidence bounds. So L and U are statistics, such that the probability that this mu lies between lower and upper bounds is equal to 0.95. Okay. What time did we start? Okay, let me finish this. So if we look at this this probability density function here, we see that because we've standardized to this random variable z, which is normally just standardly normally distributed, we can see that the probability that our random variable z lies between these calculated bounds here, these are quantiles of the level. So say alpha is 5%, then we have, because we're looking at two sides, we have 2.5% on the left tail, 2.5% on the right tail. So the probability that z is in between these two quantile levels, which are shown on the x-axis there, should be equal to 0.95. Okay. And this is the same expression, just with the formula for our z random variable substituted in. Okay, and then so if we expand this expression here in the middle in the brackets, then we have this probability expression on the top line here. So we found a lower and an upper bound, so two statistics, which are random variables, which of course depend on the sample, that will give us this 95% confidence interval for mu. So our bounds for the confidence interval. So if x bar is the sample mean of our random sample with size m, and we assume a normal distribution with our known variance sigma squared, then we have this confidence interval of level 95%, say, with this lower bound and upper bound. Okay, let's move on. So we can use z scores, which are calculated from the standard normal distribution. So two standard deviations. So if you just take a 95% quantile of a normal distribution, then you have this z-score 1.645, and similarly for a 97.5% and 99.5. Then you can substitute these values in of the z-scores into this confidence interval, and you have your x bar, and you're assuming this is known, this sigma, and you have n, of course. So this is straightforward to calculate this confidence interval. Okay, so changing levels of confidence, 90, 95%, 99%, will give you these different lengths of confidence interval. So we said this, we looked at this before, but the length of the confidence interval is a measure of the precision of our estimation. So inversely related to the confidence interval. So in practice, we want to have a level of confidence, choose a level of confidence before we carry out the experiment, which will both give us a short enough interval so we can actually make a decision based on the output of the experiment. So if we just have 99.999% confidence, then our interval will be huge, and we're not going to be able to use this for any kind of decision making. But at the same time, on the other side of the coin, we want some adequate level of confidence. So if we just choose a low confidence, then there's no meaning to what we're doing. So one easy way, well, let's say easy, maybe expensive way of reducing the length of the confidence interval is to just get more data. So choosing n large enough. But in some many circumstances, this isn't possible or expensive. Okay. So from all of the previous work we've looked at here, we know that using x bar to estimate mu, the error in our estimate, x bar minus mu, the absolute value, is less than this quantile level with confidence, 1 minus alpha. Okay. So in other words, we can be 95% confident the error will not exceed a given amount e when the sample size is given by this formula here. So n equals to z over e squared. Okay, so we can use this to say we want e to be a certain size, then decide how many data points we need to collect. Okay. Okay, let's look at the central limit theory. So the central limit theorem is one of the most remarkable results in probability. And basically, what it says is when you sum a large number of independent random variables, then the distribution of this sum is approximately normal. So this is useful because even if the random variables you're summing can have any kind of distribution, if they're independent, then you're gonna the mean of these random variables or the sum is going to be approximately normal. And this was first postulated by De Marva, who used the normal curve to approximate the distribution of number of heads resulting from many tosses of a coin, and then Laplace. And Lyapunov formalized this, and since then there's been many different proofs. But we're not going to look at the proof here. But this, you can look. It's easy to find the proof for this. Well, many different types of proofs. So, okay, what's the theorem? So if we have our sample x1 to xn taken from the population, which has mean mu and finite variance sigma squared, then if x bar is the sample mean, then the limiting distribution of x bar is given by this expression here, 1 over square root of n, sum of the samples minus n times mu over sigma. Okay, so we have square root of n, x bar minus mu over sigma. So as n tends to infinity, this is the standard normal distribution. So as I said, I'm not going to prove this here, but you can easily find some quite reasonably simple proofs of this. Okay. So when the random variables xi are normally distributed, then we see that this x bar is this expression of x bar, where you standardization of x bar is 0, 1, standard normal for all n. But what the key thing point here is that the central limit theorem states when the random variables are not normal, then we still approximate a normal distribution in our data sample. And in fact, when we have infinitely many points, we have this standard normal distribution. Okay. So we just need to have n large enough to have an approximate standard normal distribution. Okay, so this is a very powerful result. So for any population distribution that we might be looking at, discrete or continuous, say an exponential distribution or uniform or Bernoulli trials, then we see that this expression here for the standardization of the x bar is normal, standard normal. Okay. So intuitively we can see that the larger n, the more data points we have, the better the normal approximation. So, and also the closer the population of each of the xi to being normal, then the more rapidly this distribution will approach normality as n increases. Okay, so just a couple of plots to illustrate this point here. So on the left we have the random variables x are uniformly distributed, and then if we calculate the mean, the more samples we draw, then we get to this normal distribution, standard 0, 1. And similarly, if we have x as exponential. Okay. All right, we won't go. And also for discrete, this is the same for discrete random variables. So Bernoulli trials, we see this point. Okay. So the first remark is that the central limit theorem not only provides a simple method for computing approximate probabilities for sums or averages of independent random variables, it also, and this is the important point, helps to explain why so many natural populations, so much of the data we look at, exhibit approximately bell-shaped normal distribution curve. And indeed, as long as the behavior of the variable of interest is dictated by large numbers of independent contributions, it should be approximately normally distributed. Okay, in some fields, depends what data you're looking at, of course. Okay, so for instance, a person's height is the result of many, many independent factors, both genetic and environmental, and each of these factors can increase, decrease a person's height. Okay, so the CLT, the central limit theorem, guarantees that the sum of all of these many, many different independent contributions has approximately a normal distribution. Now, the second remark that we can make here is to think, how large does n need to be for this property to be useful, for this normal approximation to hold? So, of course, this depends on the actual population that you're trying to model. But a general rule of thumb that's given by statisticians is that you can be confident of a normal approximation whenever the sample size n is greater than or equal to 30. But in many cases, you can look at a much smaller number than this, depending on what the population distribution is. Okay. So the central limit theorem also allows us to use all of the procedures that we've talked about so far to derive the confidence intervals for mu in any population. So obviously we need to bear in mind these are approximate confidence intervals because it's not exact, the population is not normal. So if we have n large enough, then we have the z 0, 1, and hence we have these approximate confidence intervals given similarly as we looked at before, with these quantile levels z. And thus it follows that we have this expression of a confidence interval for mu. So 95% of the time, say, will fall in this, approximately. So this approximate version of the confidence intervals, when we don't have normality, is often referred to as a large sample confidence interval, because it's an approximation. This is a two-sided confidence interval, and we can similarly look at one side if we just look at one bound and then infinity on the other side. Okay. So that's a look at confidence intervals and why the central limit theorem is important. I guess there's not much point having a break now. Oops. No. Okay. Let's start on the second set of slides. Okay. So we've introduced the fundamentals of probability theory, conditional probability, We've looked at statistical inference and confidence intervals. Now we want to look at hypothesis testing. So we showed that we can either use a point estimate or this confidence interval. But in many situations, practically, for all of you, you want to decide whether a statement concerning a parameter is true or not true. So we want to test our hypothesis about our parameter, say the mean or the variance. So for example, suppose that a consumer protection agency wants to test a paint manufacturer's claim that the average drying time of this new special fast drying paint is 20 minutes. So we set up an experiment. A member of staff paints 36 boards using a different kind of paint and then measure the drying time. Okay. So in this example, the observed average drying time for the sample is 20.7 minutes. So what does this mean? Does it mean that the claim that 20 minutes is the drying time, is that false? Or how can we answer this problem? Is it a contradiction to the claim? So this is where we have a setup for hypothesis testing. And indeed, many problems in engineering or medical science, any of your problems that you'll apply statistical inference to, fall down to this setup of hypothesis testing. So where the statements are called hypotheses. So in this previous example, we can say that our null hypothesis, so our starting hypothesis, which is denoted H subscript 0, so that's null hypothesis, states that our mean is 20, okay? So this is the true unknown mean. Okay. Now, we have the null, and we want to test an alternative hypothesis, which is usually denoted H subscript A, or it depends. It may be if there's more than one alternative hypothesis, H1 and H2. Okay. But here, we have a choice to make. So our alternative hypothesis is either that the mean is not equal to 20 or that the mean is greater than 20. So perhaps here we're more interested in testing whether the drying time is greater than 20, and we're not so interested in if it's less than 20. Okay, so the null hypothesis usually determined in one of the following ways. So either using past experience or knowledge of the process from previous tests or experiments, or determined from some theory that's been developed and we want to test, or some modeling framework, or even from external considerations. Say, for example, in engineering, we want to test something strong enough. So we have this as a null hypothesis, that the average strength of, say, a piece of steel is some number. Okay, so this is called conformance testing. So yeah, we note here that in some situations, we want our null hypothesis to be of the form, it may seem that we want our null hypothesis to be of the form, say, mu greater than or equal to a certain value or less than, but the test procedure that we use is that mu is equal to a certain value, say mu zero. And then we test whether the null hypothesis is this equality holds, or there's reason to believe that this doesn't hold. And then we set up the alternative hypothesis in one of two ways. So either two-sided, so we say, no, the mean is not equal to this 20 minutes. Or we have one-sided, where we say mu is less than this value, or mu is greater than this value. So it's a one-sided. Okay. So this choice of hypothesis test influences the levels of the statistics you'll look at later. So for instance here, we're only interested in looking at whether the painting time, drying time is more than 20 minutes, because this is when they're going to get criticized, perhaps. Okay. And the setup of this hypothesis testing, of course, this is going to influence the decision that you make at the end, whether you make a one-sided or two-sided. This is going to have a potentially have an impact on the conclusion. So a procedure which leads to a decision is called a test of hypothesis. So we rely on the information contained in our sample, our random sample from the population. And then if this random sample gives consistent information with our null hypothesis, then we won't reject our null. But however, if our random sample says, no, this is different to what we should expect from, say, if the mean is 20, then we conclude that the null's false and we'll reject it. And say that the mean is not 20. So a fact here is that the truth or falsity of a particular hypothesis we're testing can never actually be known in certainty unless we know the entire population, and then we don't need to do any of this. So, I mean, that's not possible. So, of course, it's kind of random in this sense because we have a random sample. So when we develop this framework of hypothesis testing, we should be thinking about the probability of drawing the wrong conclusion using this hypothesis testing. And this is particularly important because if you're making decisions based on your random sample, then some of the time your decisions are gonna be wrong. And depending on what field you're in, the consequences of drawing a wrong conclusion could be important. Okay. So let's continue with this paint drying example. Okay. Imagine we're testing mean equals 20. So we have a sample of 36 panels, fence panels. We calculated the sample mean. And as we know, the sample mean is a good estimate of mu in terms of unbiasedness and consistency and efficiency. So we expect that the mean should be reasonably close to, the sample mean should be reasonably close to this population mean. So we have two possibilities. We either X bar falls close to 20 minutes and we don't reject the null, or X bar is too far away from 20 and we reject the null. So the numerical value which is computed from our sample and which we use to decide between accept or reject is called the test statistic. So now suppose we decide to reject our null hypothesis if our sample means smaller than 19.33 or larger than 20.67. These are just arbitrary numbers to illustrate the point. Okay, so if X bar falls within this interval, we don't reject, but if it's outside this interval, then we reject and say this claim is incorrect. So this region is called the critical region for the test. And the limiting bound points here are critical values. So that's just the terminology. Okay, so it's clear cut whether to accept or reject. There's no subjectivity involved here. So, of course, because this is a random sample, we have the possibility of making the incorrect conclusions. So even if the true mean was 20, then there's this possibility that the sample mean may be outside this critical region just due to sample chance, bad luck. Or there's a possibility that it will be inside the critical region even if, say, mu is 21. Okay, so these are the realities of hypothesis testing that we need to be aware of. Okay, and these two types of errors have labels. So the first error is called a type 1 error, is where we reject the null hypothesis when it's actually true. So rejecting that 20-minute claim when that's true. And then we have the type 2 error, which is failing to reject H0 when in fact it's false. Okay, so two types of error. These are important. And the relative importance of type 1 and type 2 errors will vary depending on who the statistician or the application of the hypothesis test, say, for example, in medical testing. Okay. Now, because we have this is based on random variables, the probabilities can be associated with these errors. So the probability of having a type 1 error is usually denoted with this alpha, and then we usually denote the probability of type 2 error with a beta. So, and here another piece of terminology is what's called the power of the test. So 1 minus beta is the probability where we reject H0 when it's false. It's called the power of the test. And of course, beta here depends on the true value of mu, which is unknown. Okay, let's go back to our fence painting example. So we assume that from past experience that the drying time is normally distributed with a known standard deviation sigma equal to 2 minutes. Okay, of course we don't know that for sure. Okay, so as we know, our Z random variable, our standardized mean, sample mean, is approximately 0.1 normal, then we can calculate the probability of a type 1 error. So the probability of type 1 error is the probability of sample mean being less than 19.3 plus the probability of being greater than 20.67 when in fact it's 20. Okay, so we can calculate these two probabilities and add them together, and we have here, using the standard normal distribution probability tables, then we see that alpha is equal to 0.44. So what this means that is if H0 is true, we have a 4.4% chance of rejecting it with this arbitrary rule we've set up. Okay, now let's suppose that mu equals to 21. So H0 is not actually true. Then we have this probability of type 2 error is equal to the probability that the sample mean is inside this interval when in fact the mean is outside. Okay, so we just apply again these Z scores, calculate through using the standard normal tables, then we see that beta is equal to 0.16. Okay, so with the decision rule that we arbitrarily came up with at the start, which is reject H0 if X bar is not inside this critical region, we see these normal distributions. Okay, so we see that beta would rapidly increase as mu approached the hypothesized value mu zero. Okay. So we have these two probabilities of making type 1 and type 2 errors to consider when we're designing our hypothesis test. Okay. Now, suppose that you want to reduce the error 1 probability, alpha, so the probability of making a type 1 error. So if you widen the acceptance region, for example, using our arbitrary critical region we came up with, widen this slightly, 19.2 to 20.8, then we reject if it's outside this interval. Then we recalculate alpha, and we have 0.0 0.016, which is smaller than our previous value. But of course, we don't get something for nothing. We see that beta increases to 0.27. So alpha decreases, beta must increase, and vice versa. So we have this trade-off between making type 1 errors and type 2 errors. And of course, yeah, it's impossible to make them both small at the same time. Okay. And this is a plot of the new rule. Can we see that alpha gets smaller, but beta gets a lot bigger? Okay. So usually, what you do when you're designing an experiment beforehand, you decide to set alpha to a predetermined level called the significance level of the test. This is because the hypothesis testing methods were originally inspired by jury trials. So in a trial, defendants are assumed to be innocent, so that is a null hypothesis. Then if we have strong evidence to the contrary, then they're declared to be guilty, so we reject innocence. But if there's insufficient evidence, they are declared non-guilty, so we don't reject it, not. Which is, of course, not the same as proving innocence. Rejecting not rejecting H naught is not the same as the defendant being proven innocent. So this is important to think about. Okay, so if the jury's wrong, either we have an innocent person is convicted, so type 1 error, or a guilty person is let free, type 2 error. So of course this is kind of subjective as to how important each of these errors are. So, but perhaps one would think that convicting an innocent person is a much more serious problem than letting a guilty person go free. I guess that's subjective. So in this example, maybe we'd say controlling alpha is the most important part. But in different examples, then maybe different. Okay, yeah. So the jury must be convinced beyond a reasonable doubt to push through a conviction. So usually we'd look at significance levels as we looked at before of 10%, 5%, 1%. It all depends on what the application is, how important the consequences are. And then we fix the decision rule based on alpha. Okay, so if we assume that the population is normal with a known standard deviation, now we set the significance level at alpha percent. So you're after a lower bound and an upper bound, such that alpha is the probability that x bar, the sample mean, lies outside of this interval. And as we showed before, we see that the probability of this standardization of x bar, z, is outside of this interval here, where it's just calculated similar to before. So we have our lower bound L and our upper bound U. Okay, so we have our decision rule, which is reject H naught if X bar is outside of this upper and lower. Okay. Okay. Now that, let's look at our fences again. Suppose we want to test our null hypothesis that mu is 20 against our alternative that is not 20, so two-sided, at 5% significance. Then we can calculate our lower bound. Well, this 1.96 is just comes from the alpha and then calculating the standard, the z-score. So we just plug all of these numbers in, plug in. We get 19.35 and 20.65. So at significance level of 5%, our decision rule we have is reject H naught if outside of this critical region. So now, over our samples we had before, if you think back, we observed that, in fact, the X bar of the sample was 20.75. So this is outside this interval, so reject H naught. So we can say we can challenge the manufacturer's claim that we have there's a 20-minute drying time, and we should have a 95% at least chance of being right. Now, if we consider a significance level of 1%, plug this in with the z-scores, plug it all in again, calculate this critical region, then we have this new critical region, which is wider, of course, because we have a smaller significance level. But at this 1%, we can't reject H0, so we don't dare contradict the manufacturer, because you'd be wrong with more than a 1% chance. Okay, so we can see the playoff between significance level, critical region, and how we can accept and reject. So, yeah, this is an important point. This previous situation here illustrates why we're rejecting H0 or failing to reject H0, either one of these. We're not accepting H0, we're just failing to reject. So we reject H0 at 5% level, but we don't reject at 1% level. But we don't know whether H0 is actually true or not. The same in either of those situations. Okay, so it's just a small point on the semantics, but important interpretation. Okay, so the evidence shown by our random sample that we gathered indicates that we would be wrong with a chance between 1 and 5% if we rejected H0. So testing at level 5% means that we acknowledge being wrong in at most 5% of cases. So we can reject H0 if that's our acceptable level of risk significance level. But if we're testing at 1%, then we see that we're going to be wrong at most 1% of cases. But if this is considered too risky, we want to be more than 99% certain of our decision, then we can't reject H0, since there's not enough evidence. All depends on significance levels, which are chosen before you look at your data, of course. Okay, so we can look at this problem of whether to reject or not reject H0 from the other angle and calculate the level, significance level, more accurately. So this is called a p-value. Okay, so the p-value, that's the smallest level of significance that would lead to rejection of the H0 with our observed sample data. Okay, so it's the probability that the test statistic will take on a value that's at least as extreme as the observed value when H0 is true. So if H0 is really 20, if that's true, then the p-value is the probability that we, from a random sample, our test statistic is at least as extreme. Okay, so this is an important measure of credibility of our null hypothesis. So it's interpreted as the chance of being wrong if we reject H0. So 5% chance of being wrong, or whatever our p-value turns out to be, maybe 2.5, 3, whatever. Okay, so how do we calculate our p-value? Okay. So when testing, our p-value is the probability to find the random variable, say x bar, to be more different to mu zero than the observed x bar. Right, so we have little p is equal to the probability that our sample mean is outside of this critical region when mu, in fact, is equal to the stated null hypothesis, which is equal to 1 minus the probability of x bar being inside of this critical region. Okay, so if we define our z scores of x bar, as we have been doing all along, then we have this z0 is equal to this expression, as we've had before. And as we know that our z-scores are standard normal 0, 1, we have this expression for how to calculate our p-value, which is 1 minus this probability of this expression, which is z0, being a member, being inside of this critical region. Okay, and we see that this is in fact just this expression here. So probability z is inside minus z to positive z, which is twice this 1 minus the probability density function of z0, because the normal distribution is symmetrical. Okay, so this is how we can calculate our p-values. So we've observed from our sample that we have a mean of 20.75. So we can plug this into our p-value calculation here. So p is equal to 1 minus probability of x bar in this region here. So we have that when we plug all of these numbers in, we calculate z0 to be equal to 2.25. Okay, so now we have this z score. We can just look down the standard normal distribution quantile table, or MATLAB, whatever you want to do, and you come up with this p-value of 0.024 of z being between these values. Okay, so if in fact h0 equals 20 is true, the probability we have of obtaining a random sample where the mean is at least as far away from 20 as 20.75 is 2.4%. So if we reject h0, we would be wrong with a 2.4% chance. So between 1 and 5, we've calculated that it's a 2.4% chance. If we reject h0, we will be wrong. So this means that h0 would be rejected at any level of significance greater than 2.4%. Okay, this is clear. Okay, so in practice, we typically calculate our p-value and then compare it to a predetermined significance level alpha to make a decision. So if p is less than alpha, reject h0. So p is 2.4%, it's less than 5%, so reject h0. So when you're writing research papers or presenting your results, it's standard practice to report the p-values of the of the experiments, along with instead of just saying, oh, we rejected h0. If you report the p-values, then you can see the accurate level of significance of the data set. Okay, and of course this gives readers, potentially other decision makers, the possibility to choose different significance levels, not just if you're imposing 5% or 10%. Okay. Now, if we look at a two-sided test, the alternative is mu is not equal to what we said in mu's null hypothesis, then an observed value x bar of the random variable x much smaller than our null mean, or much larger than our null mean, is evidence in direction of our null alternative hypothesis. However, if it's much smaller, then there's not evidence against the null, again, in favor of the alternative. So we must only seek evidence against our null in one direction of the alternative. So if we want to test our null hypothesis, then we have null mu equal to mu 0 against our alternative that mu is greater than what we said our mean was, and we should reject h0 if we have this value greater. And similarly, looking at the opposite tail. So again, this critical region is determined by whatever we chose alpha to be beforehand. Now, with our alternative hypothesis mu greater than mu zero, we're seeking a constant u such that the probability that our sample mean greater than u, when in fact the mu is equal to 20, say, is equal to alpha. So again, we know we have this, if we standardize this sample mean, we have is approximately 0.1, and we can calculate our upper critical value here, simply mu zero plus this z score. So and then we have this decision rule, reject H naught if X bar is greater than this upper. And we have our p value given by probability of X is equal to this 1 minus the standard normal of our z score that we calculate. So in our example before, with sample mean of 20.75, and if our alternative is mu greater than 20, at significance level 5%, then we calculate the upper bound to be 20.548. So we reject H naught. And we can also calculate the p-value. So there's two things you can do here. Choose significance, reject or fail to reject, or also you want to calculate the p-value. So we can simply calculate this. Just plug all of the numbers in. Look it up in the table, and then we have this 1.2%, which is much smaller than 5%. So you can reject. And then you have the other side of the coin. Where if you're testing the alternative that mu is less than mu zero, calculate this all very similar to before. And then our example is X bar is equal to 20.75. So we have at 5% significance, this lower bound of 19.452. So we can't reject H naught. And in fact, our p-value of this one-sided test of mu less than mu zero is 98.8%. Of course, this is huge compared to 5% because, I mean, this is what you'd expect. Okay. So far, we've assumed that we know the variance, we know the standard deviation, which allows us to directly use our sigma here in this expression. But of course, in practice, sigma's unknown. This is, so what we need to do, we need to replace our unknown sigma by an estimation of sigma. So here, this expression for S here, this is the notation for sample standard deviation. This is how this is calculated. And this denominator, 1 over n minus 1, I'll show you in a few slides why that's used. But this is the expression for the sample standard deviation. Okay, so you can plug this in to get t, which is the test statistic. Okay, which is now t distributed. Okay. Okay, so all we've changed here is that we obtain a sample standard deviation rather than a known standard deviation. So we can plug all of this in as before. So if we look at a two-sided test, H naught and then alternative not equal to mu zero, then we have this decision rule where reject the null if X bar is outside of this region here. So here we have this T has replaced the Z score that we had before. Okay, our test statistic. Okay, with our inputted sample standard deviation. Okay, and we can compute this p-value again. So all similar. Okay. For the one-sided alternatives, the rejection criteria are just similar to what we had before, just one-sided. reject if x bar is greater than this, reject if x bar is less than this. Okay, with the p-value calculations as you'd expect. So this is called a t-test, and is what is very very common test to carry out in statistical inference, rather than the z-test, which assumes the normal distribution. And of course, here, so we'll note that for the confidence intervals, a t-distribution, which has heavier tails than a normal distribution, gives extra variability due to the estimation of our sigma. So this, the extra variance comes in because we're estimating another parameter. Okay. So assuming that the population is normal, we constantly use these results. So Z is calculated here and is standard normal, and T with the estimation of sigma on the bottom here is our T statistic. But what if the population is not normal? Now, this is where the central limit theorem comes in, essentially stating that if n is large enough, then we have approximately a standard normal distribution if we look at this Z statistic, and also for the T statistic we had before. Whereas large enough is what we discussed earlier, of being perhaps greater than 30, depending on the setting and the data. And further, we know that estimating our standard deviation by using RS and plugging in doesn't dramatically affect this result. So this holds nicely for our estimation of sigma as well. And hence, we have the tests for our null hypothesis with a two-sided test if theta is known. So here we have Z input. With a sigma, or if we calculate approximate the sigma, we have this S input. Okay, very similar, but important to note. Okay. So since we're approximating, we have an approximate significance level alpha, provided that N is large enough, regardless of what the population distribution actually is. So the associated approximate phi value is given similarly to before, the 2, 1 minus the standard normal probability density of Z. Okay, we'll do that next time maybe. Okay, and then final slide for this week. So for the one-sided test, this is very similar to the two-sided. We're just looking at one side of the test. So we have a null hypothesis, mu is equal to mu zero, against an alternative where we go mu is greater than this value, or perhaps mu is less than this value. This is two separate tests. So maybe we focus on mu greater than mu zero. So we have decision rules, reject H naught if X bar is greater than this calculated statistic, or for this example, if it's less. And then plugging in S again. This is all similar from the previous slides, just one-sided or two-sided. And of course, we have the approximate p-values here. P is 1 minus this standard normal of Z0. So these tests are called large sample tests. And because we have additional approximation of the parameters, we'd perhaps say n greater than 40 would be a good starting point in terms of number of data points for these p-values to be approximately valid. Okay, I think maybe we're finished for this week. Is half six, yeah? Okay. Thanks very much for your attention. Yeah, 2 weeks, 15th.
Okay.
Hi. Thanks.